where my students didn't notify me that I couldn't see my screen. So you should be seeing my slides right now. So the title of my talk is Belief in Conspiracy Theories During a Pandemic. And the basis of my talk is really to explain why during this COVID-19 pandemic we could see so many conspiracy theories. So early in the pandemic, a very popular theory was that the COVID-19, the virus, the coronavirus that causes COVID-19 was a bioweapon that's created in the lab. There were also a lot of conspiracy theories, for instance, alleging that the pandemic was actually due to 5G radiation, so this this network for mobile communication. And of course, yeah, there's always, whenever it comes to health, lots of conspiracy theories surrounding Bill Gates. Poor Bill Gates. I seriously think he means well, but he's always a figure in many conspiracy theories, and in this case, there were conspiracy theories such as that he would be planting little microchips in the vaccines in order to make every human being on the planet remote controllable. So lots of these different COVID-19 conspiracy theories are about them. Now, let's start off with the definition. What is a conspiracy theory? So this is a common definition that you can see in the literature. So explanatory beliefs involving multiple actors who join together in secret agreements to pursue hidden goals that are widely seen as malevolent. So there's always multiple actors. It needs to be a group. It's never a lone wolf, otherwise it's not a conspiracy. There's always an element of secrecy, and it's always something evil, so to speak. Now, most commonly, most of the conspiracy theories that we can encounter in popular culture or on the internet are about powerful and legitimate institutions such as the United States government, secret service agencies, also corporate ones like oil companies. In the context of COVID-19, of course, the pharmaceutical industry, they're a topic of many conspiracy theories in the context of this pandemic. But conspiracy theories are also often about minority groups or social categories, such as Muslim conspiracy theories, which are popular in extreme right-wing groups, and Jewish conspiracy theories. There's these anti-Semitic conspiracy theories, which have been widespread across the ages, really. Now, I started believing conspiracy theories, I think 12 or 13, sorry, I started studying believing conspiracy theories about 12 or 13 years ago. And back then, many people asked me, well, what are you doing with this fringe phenomenon? Well, we now know that it's not a fringe phenomenon. These are some numbers collected from nationally representative samples from well-known agencies in various countries, asking whether or not COVID-19 was planned. That was the question posed in the United States, or created in the lab. That was asked in Canada and Australia. And here you see the figures. 25% of the population in the United States believes that, and 26% of the Canadian population believes it, and 39% of the Australian population believes that. Also in my own country, there was a sample. Actually, there we had that was in May 2020, 15%. So when this rating came out, I was invited to this radio show, and then live on the national radio, I was asked this question: aren't you shocked and surprised that the figure is this high? And I had to respond, well, actually, no, I'm pretty shocked that the figure is this low, and I can't explain why it's so low, given that it's so high in many other countries. So it's not a fringe phenomenon. It's really common among normal people who have normal jobs, who do fine in their everyday life. It's not necessarily something pathological. And as a testimony of that, there's also many very famous people who've been extremely successful who believe them. Take, for instance, Woody Harrelson, of course, a very well-known actor from the United States. When the pandemic just broke out, he posted things on Instagram suggesting that he thought that it was actually not a virus, but 5G media communication networks that were causing people to get ill. Roseanne Barr, she's actually very well known for her many conspiracy theories in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. She, at least early in the pandemic, she had the theory that the COVID-19 pandemic, that the virus causing COVID-19 was created by the United States government in order to kill elderly people and steal their pensions. Now, also in the Netherlands, here you have Robert Jensen. He was a very famous talk show host for years. Now he's more like a Dutch Alex Jones, who has his own YouTube channel in which he constantly promulgates one conspiracy theory after the other. And Doutze Kroes, that's actually the Netherlands' most famous top model. And she was in the news last year asking all these sorts of conspiratorial questions, like who's earning money from the pandemic and why aren't we given real advice how to deal with it and stuff like that. And I was actually also in the Dutch media, and I criticized her a little bit. And of course, I should have known better, because I was fishing the hate mail of her mostly male fans for 3 weeks out of my inbox in the weeks that followed. In any case, so the point here is, it's a widespread phenomenon. It's something that famous people believe, not so famous people, rich people, poor people, highly educated, lower educated people. It's really a thing that's part of social psychology, of people's normal beliefs in their normal everyday life. Now, this presentation, I will be asking two questions that are relevant for conspiracy theories during a pandemic. And the first is, are they harmful or are they harmless? Should we bother? Are people allowed? Should we, allow people to believe whatever they like, or should we be concerned about this? And then the second question is, why do conspiracy theories flourish during a pandemic? And for the second question, for this first question, I will actually rely on recent data that I collected during the pandemic. For the second question, I will mostly rely on older data from before the pandemic to answer this question. Now, first of all, can conspiracy theories do harm? Now, at the basis, I would actually like to cite one of the oldest principles in psychology, I think. Well, it's not the oldest, but a very old one at the very least, that is the Thomas theorem. And that says, if people define situations as real, they are real in their consequences. And a classic example of this Thomas theorem is that, imagine a child. I'm sure some of you have young children, sometimes children can't sleep because it's dark in their room, and then they are afraid that there's a monster underneath their bed or a ghost in the room. Well, is the monster or the ghost really there? Well, of course not. Has it real influences on real behavior? Yes, it does, because the child can't sleep and neither can the parents. So here we have a situation that a person defines a situation as real, even if it's an illusion, it still is real in their consequences. Now, and I would like to argue that the same goes for conspiracy theories too. So a classic example is vaccines. If you believe that a pharmaceutical industry has tampered with vaccines, you're simply less likely to take them. Now, there have been many incidents in society that actually suggest that these COVID-19 conspiracy theories are harmful. This is what we saw in various countries, in the Netherlands and also in the UK. I'm not sure about Germany, you tell me, but at least early in the pandemic, there were multiple of these telecommunication masts, over 20 in the Netherlands actually, put on fire by action groups who clearly saw a link between 5G radiation networks and the pandemic. So here we saw that this belief that these networks caused people to get ill, led these activists to put these masts on fire with, hundred thousands of euros damage. And also it was actually not helping people's health, but damaging to people's health, because this could also at some points cause some of the networks to go down in certain regions for a while, which is of course not very handy during a pandemic, when people may need to be able to call the emergency number. Also, and I think this is pretty much universal. I think we've seen this in any country, these anti-lockdown protests where people don't keep their distance and believe that we should release all of these restrictive measures. And what you very commonly see is these signs saying stop lying to us. There's clearly a lot of people there believing conspiracy theories. Now, at the end of the day, these examples are what they are. They're anecdotes. They're not scientific evidence. So let's have a look at the actual research. So this is what we did. We did a three-wave study in the Netherlands. It was together with my regular collaborator, André Krauwel. He's a political scientist and also the founder of Kieskompas. That's a political research organization who coordinates huge research panels in the Netherlands. So these panels are pretty much random panels, but what we did was post-stratification weighing through iterative proportional fitting, so that you provide these weights to the data and that enables you to get these nationally representative population estimates on the benchmark, gender, age, ethnicity, education, and geographical region, according to the Dutch Golden Standard. And also corrected for voting behavior. It's a political research organization. And so we did, like I said, a three-wave study. So the first wave was took place early in the pandemic when we were just in lockdown. It was in April 2020. We had over 9,000 participants there. Now, these same participants were revisited twice. The second time was in June, and we had almost 7,000 participants from the same wave back. And then the third wave was in December, where we still had more than 5,000. Now, of course, there's always some fluctuation. There may be people participating in April and in June and in December, but not in June, for instance. So at the end of the day, that we had more, almost 5,000 participants who participated in all of the waves. So I think that's a very decent score. Now, let me walk you through the results. So first, wave one, this is just a cross-sectional look at what happened early in the pandemic. So we had a range of COVID-19 conspiracy theories that we asked for, such as beliefs that corona was developed to control population growth, or that it was released by United States governments to destabilize China, that predicted decreased physical distancing. It also predicted a decreased support for lockdown policies. A decreased perception of the virus as dangerous. So the more people believe conspiracy theories, the less dangerous they thought that the virus was. We also asked for various interventions, and some of these interventions were clearly not really supported by scientists. There were a range of them really. Should we continue life as usual? Should we pray to God for the virus to go away? Should we rely more on herbal medicine? Prevent the media from spreading panic. There were a couple of others, I think. There was also one, blowing in your nose with a hairdryer that has been apparently on some websites a thing for a while. Not exactly something scientists would recommend in order to prevent you from getting corona. There was no vaccine yet, but we asked him, so imagine there's going to be a vaccine anytime soon. Would you take it? Now that you clearly saw that people were less likely to take that vaccine. This was a very interesting one. So we also asked, okay, and this was in April. So what do you think? Do you actually think you already have been infected with the virus? And we actually saw that the more people believe conspiracy theories, the more likely they were to already have been infected. Now we were intrigued by that because if we looked at actual medical test results, this actually didn't show. We actually found sort of the opposite. So apparently early in the pandemic, when you actually had a medical test of corona, apparently that could actually sort of cure people from their conspiracy theories. Now, our explanation of this is actually, so if you think it's just a flu, and then you know what, a couple of weeks before you had sort of flu-like symptoms, you weren't feeling so well, then it's these conspiracy theories actually prompt you to believe that, I've already been infected anyway. And this only reinforces beliefs such as, you see, it's not so harmful after all. And we actually found that that this is a mediator of this physical distancing, between COVID-19 and physical distancing. So trust in institutions, that's a link that has been argued frequently. Various authors and in various publications already have said, the reason that there's this link between COVID-19 and physical distancing is because of trust in institutions. So if you believe these conspiracy theories, You don't trust these institutions anymore, and therefore you also don't really do what they say anymore. But we found that this path, we replicated, but we also found that this was an independent additional path to explain physical distancing. People who believe conspiracy theories think they've had it already anyway, even though that's not supported by our data on actual medical tests. Now, let's also have a look at conspiracy theories over time, because we, of course, had this longitudinal setup, and I think we should capitalize on that. Now, that longitudinal design enables us to compare two conflicting perspectives. Well, conflicting, they can actually both be true, but there are different lines of reasoning. Now, the first line of reasoning is what I've just argued for. So conspiracy theories are influential, and then the idea is that conspiracy theories should shape people's attitudes and behavior over time. So, and then the idea is if people believe these conspiracy theories, you know, and then increasingly they get confronted with, the effects of the lockdown measures, and they see stores go bankrupt, and they see all the consequences of that, and they conspiracy theories only make them resent that more and more. So conspiracy theories at time one predicts a progressive decrease in support for these measures like physical distancing over time. Now, and then the second idea, I read this book, and I thought it was really inspiring, and it actually argues for something opposite, actually. That's, I thought that was really clever, and that's the idea that maybe conspiracy theories are sort of a justification mechanism. So, and this, of course, relates very closely to older theories such as cognitive dissonance and self-perception theory. And the idea is that conspiracy theories may actually help people justify their beliefs and behavior. So if early in the pandemic, you already didn't really like these lockdown policies and this physical distancing, and over time you get confronted more and more with these conspiracy theories, and they actually give you a reason not to support these restrictive measures. So they help you to justify your resentment against physical distancing. Now, and if this is true, then physical distancing at time one should predict increased conspiracy thinking over time. So the opposite order, actually. Now, we use the wave two data to compare these opposing ideas. Now, the first one, are conspiracy theories influential over time? So we empirically controlled for gender, age, education, political orientation, and physical distancing at time one. And the answer appeared to be yes. So conspiracy beliefs at time one progressively predicted a decreased physical distancing at time two, also after controlling for physical distancing at time one. So this is, this idea is supported. Now, are they a justification mechanism? So, of course, like I said, it can easily both be true. Eh? So, and then again, we empirically controlled for the same control variables and for conspiracy beliefs at time one. Now, I would like you to remind of two things. First of all, I genuinely thought that this was a good and clever idea. I genuinely believed in it. And second, we have really a lot of participants to test it. So if there's anything there, it should be significant. However, we found nothing, a flat line, really. So, I still am sort of sympathetic towards this idea, but in our data, we couldn't support it. Now, are they harmful during a pandemic? So, during the pandemic, so I'm also going to turn to wave three in a moment, but for first a conclusion so far. So, during the pandemic, conspiracy beliefs predict detrimental health beliefs and behaviors over time, such as decreased physical distancing, but also some of the other variables. And we found no support for the idea that people use conspiracy theories as a mechanism to justify the detrimental health behavior. So decreased physical distancing doesn't predict increased conspiracy belief over time. Now, then the third wave enabled us to have a look at what about the long term. So keep in mind, the first wave was in April in 2020, and the third wave was in December. So here you see, it was just before Christmas. So I thought this picture was sort of suiting the Santa Claus with wearing a face mask. But of course, the idea is, so to what extent would conspiracy believing in April 2020 predicted what people's life would look like by December 2020. Now, and most of the questions that we asked were concrete behaviors to be answered in a dichotomous format. Did you do this? Did this happen? Yes or no? And what we found was, we asked them, so have in the past month, have you been tested for corona? So now, in conspiracy belief in April, predicted a decreased likelihood of having been tested. If tested, an increased likelihood of the test coming out positive. I should mention, we only found this in the sample that we weighted to be nationally representative, and we didn't found it in the raw unweighted one, but still I thought it was interesting. And of course, that's in line with this idea that if you don't follow up on all these restrictive measures, yeah, in the long run, you are more likely to get corona, really. An increased likelihood of having violated corona regulations. So we asked them a couple of things. So have you received more visitors in your house than was allowed? Have you visited a bar or restaurant where it was more crowded than allowed? So that was also more likely among conspiracy believers. Face masks, that was an interesting one because, yeah, of course, in April, no one was wearing face masks and they were not available really in the Netherlands, except for the healthcare workers. And actually, the government up until the summer proclaimed that that it was useless. So that was the Netherlands was a bit of an interesting case. But now, yeah, fortunately, they changed their mind. But at least the conspiracy believers in April, yeah, predicted decreased likelihood of wearing face masks in December. Oh, this was also interesting. So we also asked, did you, happen to lose your job during the pandemic? And we actually found that the conspiracy believers were more likely to have lost their job. This was only in the weighted sample again, not in the unweighted one. What we did found in both the weighted and the unweighted was also, did you have increased financial problems during the past months? Now you may wonder, why is that the case? So how may that be? Why job loss? Why financial problems? Well, what we actually found is that conspiracy believers are simply more likely to have a decreased social support network. So they're more likely to experience social rejection. And we actually found that this was a one-way street. So we asked two questions. Did you, because of other people's opinion on corona, terminate end your contact with them? And also reverse, did other people and contact with you due to your opinion about corona? And what the data showed was actually that it was, like I said, a one-way street. So it seemed to suggest that people who do not believe conspiracy theories are more likely to reject and end contact with people who do believe conspiracy theories, as opposed to vice versa. So this actually suggests that our society is actually quite intolerant of conspiracy believers at the moment. And also we asked for, yeah, general well-being, so problems like did you suffer from panic attacks, temper tantrums, that sort of thing. So general well-being was also, yeah, lower in December 2020 among people who believed conspiracy theories in April. So can conspiracy theories do harm? Actually, yes, apparently they can in the long run. It predicts whether or not people mind these corona regulations, whether or not they take them seriously. They're less likely to get tested. They're more likely to test positive. They're more likely to get into economic trouble. So yes, it is something we should be concerned about. Oh, sorry. Yes. Now, and then I would like now to continue with my second question. So why do these conspiracy beliefs flourish during a pandemic? And like I said, I will rely for this part mostly on some of my older work, although I also will present some studies that I conducted very recently in the context of the pandemic, actually. Now, one basic insight in the psychology of conspiracy beliefs is that they particularly emerge in societal crisis situations. So previous research has found links between feelings of anxiety, feeling that things are not under their control anymore, feelings of uncertainty. And these are beliefs that people are, of course, likely to experience, particularly in societal crisis situations such as a pandemic. And not just a pandemic. So we can see this throughout history, really. That's not only in pandemics, so now corona, but also the 1918 Spanish flu, actually. There were also conspiracy theories back then. At the time, there were, for instance, it was also the end of the First World War. So then countries such as France and England actually blamed Germany for the pandemic at the time. So they thought they deliberately had caused it. It was called the Spanish flu. That was actually unfair because the Spanish flu didn't start in Spain at all. It was observed in the United States and in France way before it was observed in Spain. But oh well, that's some of these historical trivia. And we also see them far more often when there's an economic crisis, when there's a war or terrorism. In 2019, there was this fire in the Notre Dame in Paris. It already seems like ages ago, but it really was only 2 years ago, and there were also lots of conspiracy theories about that event, such as that Jewish people had ignited it, or the French government had ignited it, or Muslims groups had ignited it. With one common theme, it was on purpose. Now, why do these events, these crisis events that raise distress, stimulate conspiracy theories? Now, I will argue that it will trigger three complementary processes that jointly make us more susceptible to conspiracy theories. So particularly when we feel distressed, it influences how the mind processes information. It also influences how we perceive our social world. It specifically increases people's tendency to view the world in us versus them terms. And this also is related to, and I'll show how this is also related to conspiracy thinking. And third, if we feel distressed, it also polarizes people's opinions. So you can see more populism and also more political extremism when people experience this psychological distress. Now, let's start with mental processes. So pattern perception, that is all about connecting dots. You can, for instance, clearly see that in many conspiracy theories where people see causal relationship between events that are not necessarily related and see all sorts of meaning and purpose in events. So the QAnon movement thinks, for instance, that all the chaos that happened in the White House under Trump, that it was part of some sort of sophisticated plan to beat the Democratic deep state. So that's what we call pattern perception. Now, prior research has actually shown that feelings of distress, so in particular feeling out of control, increases the mind's tendency to perceive patterns. So when people feel out of control, they start, for instance, seeing more conspiracy theories, but also more patterns in snowy pictures, more illusory correlations in stock market information, and so on. Now, what does that imply for conspiracy theories? So these are a couple of studies that I did with Karen Douglas, also one of the speakers in your series I saw, and a former student of mine, Clara de Innocencio. So we had a computer algorithm throw a coin at random and 100 times, and we divided them in chunks of 10. Now here you see two of these chunks. And so we asked participants, so what do you see here? Is this fully random, or is this or do you see patterns here? Is this produced by a non-random process? Now, and quite often people do see patterns in these sort of coin toss outcomes, and it comes because people don't understand randomness too much. So here you, for instance, see five times tails in a row. But that easily happens. That's what randomness is all about. Randomness doesn't nicely alternate like heads, tails, heads, tails. True randomness easily comes in clusters and more often than our minds intuitively actually would expect. So yeah, randomness comes in clusters. That's actually an interesting insight. Now, we showed this to our participants and asked whether or not they saw patterns. And then we also asked for a range of conspiracy theories, such as about the moon landings being filmed in a TV studio and the 9/11 terrorist strikes being an inside job. And we actually found a pretty solid correlation between pattern perception and conspiracy belief. In another study, we showed participants paintings by Jackson Pollock. This is an example. People differ widely in opinion what they think about these paintings. Some people see nothing in these paintings. It's the paint splashed on canvas. Other people see all sorts of figures and geometric interesting stuff in there. I leave it up to you what you see in it. I have zero judgment about that. What we do know is that the more people saw patterns in these paintings, the more likely they also were to believe all sorts of conspiracy theories. There were also other studies finding something similar. So, for instance, a study by Reine van der Waal showed that conspiracy beliefs are related with stronger beliefs that spurious relations represent a true causal relationship. So an example of a question that they, for instance, asked was, an example of a spurious relation that they focused on, for instance, was the notion that the more chocolate is being consumed in a country, the more Nobel Prize winners live in that country. Well, to my mind, that's clearly a spurious relation, but conspiracy believers see more actual true causal relationships in that sort of statements. Now, besides pattern perception, we also have a mental property called agency detection. And this is also a clear element of conspiracy theories where everything is intentional. And that's what agency detection is about, perceiving intention. Nothing happens in coincidentally in the many conspiracy theories. Same with many other sorts of beliefs, such as, belief in paranormal phenomena, such as belief in ghosts. That's also about seeing agency among people that are actually, not alive anymore. And also, there's also a phenomenon that's closely associated with called teleological thinking, where people think, for instance, stuff like the weather have a goal or a purpose, and that there's a reason why it's raining. Well, that's, I think also a form of agency detection. What does research show? So illusory agency detection is also related to conspiracy beliefs. So, for instance, if you show the classic Hydra and Simmel footage to participants, these geometric figures that move around a little bit on the screen, and then you ask participants to what extent they think these figures have agency, then the more they believe in conspiracy theories, the more agency they also see in these pictures. And also, agency detections get triggered when people are distressed. Now, a second element of conspiracy thinking I'd like to focus on is social perception into group conflict. So also here goes when people are anxious or distressed, you can see more conflict between groups. You can, for instance, see that in the United States when there's elections and there's something at stake and there's a competition, this only increases polarization between Democrats and Republicans. And this is also manifested in mutual conspiracy theories. So intergroup conspiracy really is about, an outgroup that's conspiring in secret to harm our in-group. And what Oshinsky and Parent, for instance, found is that conspiracy theories are for losers. What they actually mean by that is conspiracy theories are for election losers. So the moment, for instance, Democrats lose an election like they did in 2016, they're more likely to believe conspiracy theories such as that Trump rigged the election. Now, when it's reversed, such as 2020, when Biden wins the election and Trump lost, well, I'm sure we all remember what happened then with allegations of election fraud and so on. So, intergroup conflict is really closely related with conspiracy theories. And we find that, not only between Democrats and Republicans, but also at other levels. It can also happen between nations. So, of course, Donald Trump clearly blamed China for the pandemic. He explicitly called it a Chinese virus and also indicated to believe, to have evidence that it was created, that the coronavirus was created in a Chinese lab in Wuhan. Was this a one-way street? Actually, no, this wasn't. This is actually a high-ranked Chinese diplomat, Zhao Lian. And he actually also had conspiracy theories that blamed the United States for the coronavirus. So he, for instance, said it might be the United States military that brought the coronavirus to Wuhan. Now, we actually did some studies on these China versus United States conspiracy beliefs. I should note that we carried out these studies in the spring of 2019, so before the pandemic. And at the time, we did it actually more in the context of the trade war that was going on between these countries. I had I worked together with Mindy Song, that was a very bright student of mine, and she was Chinese. And we do nowadays a lot of studies in the UK and the US through websites such as Prolific or Mechanical Turk. But thing is, in China, you also have similar websites where you can also do studies using crowdsourcing. The only thing is you do need to speak Chinese and translate your stimulus materials in Chinese. But she could do that. So what did we do? We through MTurk, we collected over 250 United States participants and on a Chinese website, comparable Chinese website. We collected also 228 Chinese participants. This took place in the spring of 2019. And among United States participants, we asked questions such as the secret agency of China has been trying to influence political decision making in America. And in China, it literally read like this, but I can't really read that. And I'm sure many of you can't either. But what it translates to is the secret agency of America has been trying to influence political decision making in China. So mutual conspiratorial allegations. Now, what did we found? First of all, this is always interesting. It's a bit more difficult to do this through Zoom. If I was now in Bochum and talking live to you, I would ask you to raise your fingers and tell me where these conspiracy theories were highest. And I did that in two talks right before the crisis. And both of the time, 70 to 80% of the people sitting there unanimously thought that it would be higher in the United States. And I did so too, and before I started my research. But my student instantly said, no, this is going to be prepared. This is going to be way and way higher in China. And she was right, actually. This was actually much higher in China. It was actually more than a full point on a 7-point scale higher, about 1.2 on a 7-point scale higher, really. And this was due to cultural differences in the acceptance of hierarchy in society and also higher levels of collective narcissism and a stronger belief that the outgroup process is a threat to the country. Now, what's the basic idea? That in countries where there's hierarchy, so through power distance and vertical collectivism, people are more inclined to put the goals of the group prior to their own goals. And that also makes them more sensitive when another group is threatening their nation. So they're essentially more proud of their nation and therefore also more angry and more conspiratorial when a country like the United States goes into a trade war with them. Now, this was the full model that we found. And note that these two variables, collective narcissism, so extreme in-group favoritism and perceived out-group threat are both critical ingredients of perceiving inter-group conflict. Now, this was the full model that we found. Here we indeed see that conspiracy theories is something that takes place between groups and that it's rooted in intergroup conflict. Now, this is another study this is one that we did very recently. This was actually in the context of the pandemic and then particularly in terms of vaccine hesitancy. So this was a United States sample and we gave them this narrative. There were two conditions, a Chinese vaccine and a United States vaccine. And we told them there's this vaccine, which was either developed in China or in the United States. It's very safe. It's 95% effective. Imagine you could take it tomorrow. Would you do it? And we also asked for conspiracy beliefs, such as the beliefs that the vaccine had been tampered with. Now, this United States sample was far more likely to take this United States vaccine than this Chinese vaccine. And it was also mediated by their belief in conspiracy theories. Now, why are these effects due? Was this because people all over the world think these United States vaccines are actually oh so superior? Actually, well, we did sort of the same. So I included my PhD student, Haiyan Wang, in the project. And she was really excited about it. And she instantly told me, I think this is going to be reversed in China. She actually knew some of her Chinese friends who were highly educated and yet traveled back to China in order to get vaccinated with the Chinese vaccine because they didn't trust the Western vaccine. So we ran the same materials, or almost the same materials, I should say. Some of the conspiracy theories were, a bit off base in China, but most of the stimulus material in China. And this is what we found. We found a complete reversal for a vaccine intention. So they were actually far more likely to take the Chinese vaccine than the United States vaccine, and also more likely to believe conspiracy theories about the United States than about the United States vaccine than the Chinese vaccine. So here, we again see this notion of intergroup conflict during a pandemic in this case, in vaccine hesitancy and conspiracy beliefs. Now, then the third thing I would like to talk about. So when people are distressed and anxious, we know from research that that polarizes their opinions. People become more populist. And a lot of these populist movements are known for their conspiracy theories. So think of, for instance, the movement that initiated the Brexit referendum. What was a good predictor of voting in favor of Brexit? It was two types of conspiracy theories, really. The belief that the referendum would be rigged and the belief in Islamophobic conspiracy theories, so, such as that there's this Muslim conspiracy in the European Union that the UK needed to get away from. Now, and of course, well, I don't think we really need to talk about Trump. That was also a populist extreme movement. And well, of course, the conspiracy theories were really part of everything, of their campaign. For 4 years, we have been seeing, we could see this going on. Now, we did a study on what we called, a phenomenon that we called populist gullibility. So we actually looked at whether or not populist attitudes were related to conspiracy theories, but also whether or not it would predict a range of other beliefs that people hold. And so we found that populist attitudes, after controlling for political orientation, because populism can be a left and a right-wing thing, so it was reliably associated with conspiracy beliefs in 13 EU countries, actually. On other samples that was more like American samples, we also looked at other variables, such as how credible they thought news was if presented by mainstream channels, by alternative channels. So they just thought it was all more credible. We also looked at a variable bullshit receptivity. That's actually a viable academic term nowadays. So participants are simply given nonsense statements that are grammatically correct, but they're just buzzwords placed together in a sentence, and asked them whether or not they saw some deeper meaning in that. That's a scale that was inspired by the tweets of Deepak Chopra, actually. So populist attitudes predicted more bullshit receptivity. And they were also more likely to believe in the paranormal. And we found that this actually was mediated by a reliance on intuition. So populist attitudes are rooted in a gullible mindset that intuitively accepts ideological neutral information as true. So the more populist, we actually found that the more populist people were, the more they just believed everything. Now, and I know that in the media, populist citizens are often portrayed as angry and critical citizens. And well, they're definitely angry citizens, but these data suggest they're not critical citizens, they're gullible citizens. And I think that also explains why these citizens buy into the narrative of populist movements and populist leaders. This is also some older finding of us. So we looked at political extremism. So these are results from two nationally representative samples. So conspiracy beliefs are more prevalent among both the left and the right extremes of the political spectrum. I'm actually also part of a bigger research team that tried to replicate this in 28 countries. And yeah, actually, incidentally, we now just got a revise and resubmit in our inbox earlier this week. So we're very excited that that will get published. So in 28 countries, I must say there was some variance across countries. So in some of the countries, it was more prominent at the right. There were also some countries in Eastern Europe where it was a little bit more prominent at the left, actually. But by and large, we replicated this curve. It was slightly tweaked towards the right, so slightly higher at the right extreme than at the left extreme. But we clearly did see overall this curve emerging. So it's really something that we can find at both extremes. Now, of course, populism and extremism by looking at political ideology on a scale that looks still at regular citizens that go out and vote that aren't necessarily breaking the law. So this is actually a study that was done by qualitative researchers that I thought was really interesting, and that was published in 2010. And they looked at extremist groups that don't follow the law, like left-wing extremist groups such as the RAF, who committed various attacks in the late 70s, and groups of neo-Nazis, religious fundamentalist groups such as Al-Qaeda. There were also a couple of groups that weren't easy to classify. Think of anti-technology groups. You know, that's an example of a group that's also can also be extremist, yet not really clearly one ideology. Very different ideologies. What did they have in common? So these researchers looked at their documentation and speeches and scored their documentations for conspiracy theories. And they actually apparently had largely, there were a couple of exceptions, but most of them had one thing in common. And that was that they believed that their speeches and documentation, you know, were flooded with all sorts of conspiracy theories. The type of conspiracy theories differed a little bit. So, you know, like the left-wing groups were, and it was mostly about, you know, multinationals and United States, for instance, whereas right-wing groups were more like, you know, scientists and Muslims and Al-Qaeda then is of course all a Western conspiracy to subvert Muslims and so on. But there were also common themes, like many of these groups believed in, for instance, a secret and hidden world government. That was actually something many of these groups, independent of ideology, believed in. So now to get back to my second question, so why do conspiracy beliefs flourish during a pandemic? I noted that it's a distressing experience, and we know from previous research that distress influences us at three levels, and these levels are all related to conspiracy thinking. So it influences basic mental operations such as pattern perception and agency detection, and we have seen that these are related to conspiracy theories. When people are distressed, they also start classifying the world more into us versus them. And we have seen in the studies comparing the United States with China that also, that also breeds conspiracy theories. And polarized opinions. When people are distressed, we know from prior research that it polarizes people's opinion. It makes them more extreme in their attitudes. And yeah, this is really something that has been noted now many times by many researchers. So these radical beliefs are heavily intertwined with conspiracy beliefs. And with that, I'm at the end of my talk, and I look forward to hearing your questions. So thank you very much.